Thank you for keeping us company. And if you just tuned in, this is Y254 Discussion Monday begins right now. My guest tonight is Job Mugira. He's an economist. We are talking about the NHIF circular that was released where we will be required to pay upfront amount. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Hilary. How are you?
I'm very well. Now, I don't know whether you are saddened as I am by this circular, where members who default and new members will have now to wait for 90 days rather than the 60 days that was previously. How do you feel this report?
Well, before I get sad, I take some time to digest what exactly would make me sad. And about the NHIF circular, I'll say I have mixed feelings, but now when I look at the common Kenyan, I'm sad. Mm-hmm. If I look at the NHIF board and maybe their experts, they had some reasons.
Right.
Yeah.
Maybe before we talk of how we got ourselves here, when the current regime came into power, they came with four agendas, and one of them was universal health care. And as the report is clearly saying, it is in the aim of achieving the universal health care. And then one would be left to wonder, how about the small SMEs we have out there? How about the mama mboga? How about that person who is in the mjengo industry? They cannot live over a dollar in a day. How do you expect them to achieve this?
Well, I think the measures on that circular that was circulated sometimes early this year, or maybe in the course of last week, does not lead directly to the achievement of the Big Four agenda. Mm-hmm. Even in simple psychology, sometimes you can punish, let's say, a kid until they get used. So if it's a matter of the Big Four agenda and the universal health care, we should make everything attractive to the common man. True. But what this circular is doing is making NHIF very unattractive to the common man.
True.
This thing, NHIF has been as old as 1966, and so many people have prescribed to the same, that is, are registered and they are members. But now with the new measures in place, I think we are going in a direction that so many members will be lost.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So now the big question is, how did we find ourselves here that they have now sat down and decided now it's no longer 60 days but 90, and then we have a penalty of 50%, and if you have defaulted, all those regulations, how did we get into here?
Well, that's a good one, and I'll explain it this way. How we got ourselves here, that is the board sitting and deciding to revise those conditions. And there could be so many pressures, economic pressures. Of course, sometimes economy inakuwa ngumu to everyone. Number two, the issue of public debt could have drawn us there. If you look at the financial statements for NHIF, for example, for the year 2017, 2018, the revenues were somewhere at, I think, 47 billion, if I'm not wrong. And if you subtract all the expenses, that's the monies that are paid to the hospitals and the administrative costs, you realize there was some surplus of like 2 billion. Now, probably they are looking for a bigger surplus. And number three, insurance is just insurance. You bring resources together, then we take care of you, depending. You could be having a bigger risk, a smaller risk, but the insurance will make all of you equal. So the third reason here, NHIF has decided, in my opinion, to go commercial. That is all the measures, if you look at them closely, you realize they've gone the way other commercial companies would do their insurance to make sure the risk is minimized and the revenue is increased. Of course, it will result into profit.
Okay.
Or let's call it, because it's a parastatal, surplus. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So for whatever reason they may have had to come up with this kind of a plan or a strategy, they have done it, I don't know, to the expense of the
common
poor people.
Man.
Because already with the current system, there were a few facilities or a few services that I could have achieved with the principal that I pay. Actually, the NHF is that level that wouldn't have gone. But now it has been put in a place where, again, actually, I thought they would have brought it down to accommodate everyone.
I think, as I said, this one is going to exclude, mm-hmm. not include. So there'll be an issue of exclusivity. And how do we get people excluded? If you use simple maths, the first rule is there should be an upfront pay. Mm-hmm. That is, if you pay 500, you're expected to pay 6,000 upfront. Then you wait for 90 days to enjoy the services. Mm-hmm. Now, 6,000 for a common man, that's like admitting another person, another kid in school. Mm-hmm. That's the local schools. Mm-hmm. So will you pay school fees? These are people surviving on less than a quarter a dollar a day. Will you pay school fees? Will you pay an HIF? Mm-hmm. Will you buy food? Will you buy clothing? Or
even pay rent?
And if you're living in a rented place, will you be able to pay? Mm-hmm. So look here, it's natural, it's common, mm-hmm. it's obvious. Being sick, you are not sick now, but you anticipate to be sick. Mm-hmm. But school fees, it's now, the date is set. So you will sort what you can see here, and people will pay school fees. And then in the process, now you are caught in the defaulting tragedy.
You now have to pay.
If you default again, you are thrown out. Mm-hmm. So the following year, you're supposed to pay so many penalties mm-hmm. and another upfront, then wait again for 90 days. Mm-hmm. So people will choose to survive on Panadol. And then the universal health care again is affected.
There was an argument, you're paying all this amount of money, but also when you go to the hospitals, it has been proven, there are no medicines. You're told, go to a certain pharmacy, you will get this. Then why would someone continue paying the NHIF if they will not facilitate their services fully?
Well, I'm a social researcher to some extent, in addition to economics, and I've talked to several people since those regulations were made public. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I'll tell you, Kenyans are not so much against those regulations. Kenyans are so much mm-hmm. against how they benefit from NHIF.
Right.
And this is it. If you do a blind survey, that is, you're not telling people where they are doing a survey, mm-hmm. you're not giving people these regulations to read. You're just telling them, do you support the new directives by NHIF? Most Kenyans will tell you no. They don't even know which directives.
Mm-hmm.
You can try it. I know you have a mic somewhere. Just walk around some of these streets. Mm-hmm. Kenyans will tell you no. They don't even know the regulations. Reason, it's associated with NHIF and to some extent public money. We've seen their receptionists driving high-end cars, living in very good houses, buying mansions that so many Kenyans cannot afford. Then you want a Kenyan to believe that by adding premiums or by paying penalties mm-hmm. or by paying upfront mm-hmm. that they will receive better services. No, the history is Kenyans are suffering.
Mm-hmm.
You go to hospitals, processing even the NHIF claims is not as easy. Those are some of the build-ups that are making Kenyans oppose everything that is said. If you go preaching that they should not accept it, mm-hmm. I'll tell you they will not accept it. Not because it's so bad, but because of the experience with receiving the services. Mm-hmm. So in my opinion, if those regulations are to stay, because so many people have lobbied for them to be discarded,
mm-hmm.
if they are to stay, then NHIF should be fair enough to make people enjoy
right.
the services. If you go to the commercial insurance companies, several of them make your life easy when you get involved in an accident or such.
Mm-hmm.
But for NHIF, you are in a risky situation, you're sick, mm-hmm. but you still have to suffer following up.
True.
We can't add premiums. People should not add premiums or be penalized mm-hmm. when the commensurate benefits.
Now, there's something interesting that will definitely touch on some of the cultural activities in some of the regions, and I just want to read it how it is now. For national scheme members, number of dependents per card to be limited to a maximum of one spouse and 5 children. Okay, I already see a reaction. Now, for management scheme, it will be capped at one person, then six. But now the question is, a person who has say two wives, or probably you're not just having two wives, you have seven kids. How will you pay for this five in one card, then another one for that particular card? Because there's a regulation, it has cut across, or someone who takes care of kids, maybe from their brother or their sister, as in you are a family person, you have this kind, this number of children. How are you now going to divide them, and still you're not able even to raise them?
Well, I smiled because of how you used the word cultural activities to refer to polygamy.
Parents to some societies.
Yeah, it's cultural, it's choice, whatever you'd like to call it. Mm-hmm. But I'll say, in the spirit of our constitution, that particular rule mm-hmm. is discriminative. Mm-hmm. And it's discriminative in this manner. You have two wives. When you went looking for a second wife, you didn't consult an HIF to give you permission. Mm-hmm. So here now they want to come and be party to your personal life. if you look at the Act in 1966, mm-hmm. it was a department in the ministry. And I think at that point, they accommodated everyone. Mm-hmm. Your two wives, your three wives, your four wives, provided they are legally
mm-hmm. married to you.
Mm-hmm. Now, five children. If the normal family from the recent census was three, around three kids, 2.9, but let's call it three. Mm-hmm. Now, if you have two wives, you have six kids. Which kid will you tell that you are not covering them? Mm-hmm. Do you exclude the firstborn? Do you exclude the lastborn? Or which one will you exclude mm-hmm. on your wives? NHIF maybe wants those polygamous people to stop it. But that is not the way to go. If you want to regulate population again by saying you should not give birth to more than five children, mm-hmm. then let's come up with a law first that will regulate us from giving birth to more than five kids. Mm-hmm. Then NHIF should come up with a cover mm-hmm. that is consistent with the Constitution. Mm-hmm. Currently, we are not limited by the Constitution on the number of children you should have. Mm-hmm. So if you tell now NHIF to regulate these people, we may require to amend the law and say now, because of how our population is going and we are not able to offer universal health care, mm-hmm. let's limit children to five. Mm-hmm. So I think Parliament, the National Assembly, has a chance to save those cultural activities. Mm-hmm. Maybe I believe in so many communities where polygamy is allowed, they have their own reasons, mm-hmm. and the Constitution allows that. So let the parliamentarians from those places take these regulations, subject them to discussions in parliament mm-hmm. in a bid to save their people. And again, we should not discriminate on the sixth child. Every kid mm-hmm. has a reason why they are born.
Yeah. Actually, there's something you mentioned, like trying to control or a certain behavior or bring a certain moral in the society. But then here is a person, they are taking care of their nephews and nieces. How now do I start favoring my children over my nephews and nieces? Or maybe how do I now go about it, telling them I can only cover my children, but you are not mine?
Well, I think from general insurance, leaving out your nieces and nephews, it's very much okay, because again, I know for your dependents, you must prove that you are dependents. If it's a niece or a nephew, mm-hmm. then you must prove you are the guardian and there is no other guardian, so that people will not pick their neighbors. So that would be very much hard. Mm-hmm. The issue is the kid, the biological kid, or maybe an adopted kid, someone who can be attributed to you. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. I don't know. Time is much running. But now the whole system, an organization that is KOTU has come out clearly and said we were not consulted. I don't know how many people will come out to say they were not consulted. Actually, I would want us to listen in to what was said yesterday in the presser in regards to KOTU being consulted about the NHIF circular. Maybe we
punitive, retrogressive, irresponsible, and are being pushed by individuals hell-bent on suffocating the smooth operations at the NHIF and at the same time aimed at frustrating workers who religiously contribute to the fund. GOTU demands that NHIF management withdraws the said circular immediately and engages all social partners on the issues raised before any changes are made to the services and benefits enlisted to contributors. We have already written to the fund chief executive seeking an urgent meeting with both top management and board for them to clarify all these issues at even before the meeting takes off. One thing is certain, GOTU Kenya will not be party to such punitive changes against our members, and we are ready to explore all avenues to stop NHIF from reckless attempts to deny our members the services they deserve.
Hillary, mm-hmm. GOTU, mm-hmm. or anybody who purports to speak on behalf of GOTU mm-hmm. is lying. For this simple reason,
right.
Look at the composition of the NHIF board, and mm-hmm. we hear these regulations mm-hmm. or deliberations of a special board meeting in December. GOTU is represented. Mm-hmm. And when you come to how board decisions are made, even if the person representing GOTU in NHIF board was not in that day, he must have sent his apology mm-hmm. and he must have been briefed
of happened.
The deliberations. Mm-hmm. FKE, the Federation of Kenyan Employers,
right.
was represented. In fact, is represented. Faith-based organizations are represented. NAT is represented. Ministry of Public Service is represented. Kenya Medical Association is represented. And the Ministry of Health mm-hmm. is represented. So my question mm-hmm. is very simple. Where were these people who are telling us they were not consulted? We had someone in GOTU. Mm. In that mm. board meeting. But now again, Kenyans should be very keen about their representation. Do we have weak representatives for Kenyans in the NHIF? Mm. Because when you're talking about stakeholders and the stakeholder that GOTU has sent there, faith-based organizations have sent there, is doing nothing in that board, then those representatives should just be sent packing.
Then I think in such a representation, a question would be the people who represented, were their voices heard? Maybe GOTU is saying we were not consulted because they raised an issue that was not addressed or they were ignored.
Let them show us board minutes mm-hmm. that GOTU representative refused to sign because these decisions are signed by a certain quorum. Let FKE come today and tell us this was our dissenting voice. But as long as they do not have that, Wakenya wanafaa wajue wako peke yao, and that is the truth of the matter. So people in Nairobi who go to Nairobi Hospital, who go to Aga Khan Hospital and Mpisha, using their employers, in fact, GOTU's money, workers' money to pay for a private scheme, are telling us now that they were not consulted. Consulted by who? They were there. So anybody who says he was not consulted, it is from GOTU, FKE, faith-based, not Ministry of Public Service or Ministry of Health, should show us. Should nowadays we screenshot. Mm-hmm. Let them screenshot. I don't want to say whose way. Mm-hmm. Let them screenshot their dissenting voice mm-hmm. in those minutes.
All right. In the next 1.5 minutes, maybe you could give us your recommendations and what you feel is the way forward about this whole thing. Should Kenyans go for it? Who is our savior and what should be done?
Well, Kenyans here, they are between a rock and a hard stone. The regulations have already been made public. And unless the National Assembly saves us, we don't have any other savior. If you refuse to pay as a Kenyan, you're already defaulting. And when you will be paying, GOTU will come again and say, mm-hmm. we were not consulted. Mm-hmm. So the National Assembly should pick those that particular circular. I'm mm-hmm. happy the Health Committee has said also they were not consulted or mm-hmm. the discussion was not taken to them for approval. Let them get those regulations mm-hmm. and work on them, advise on the best way possible. Kenyans should not be ignorant. Because here now we are talking about expectant mothers. If you don't register your pregnancy and pick your card within the first 3 months, you won't enjoy those services. So Kenyans also should be very vigilant. and be very keen on what NHIF is doing and everybody is doing. But as we speak, we may find ourselves being bound by these regulations unless the National Assembly and especially the Health Committee in Parliament saves us.
All right, many thanks for coming and sharing your opinion in regards to this NHIF circular that was released. Hopefully, the National Assembly saves the Kenyans. And if you're back home, you've had Kamauja Skia Imaneno, especially our expectant ladies and mothers. It's time you be cautious, because actually, you need to be aware of these things, because they say ignorance has no defense. Many thanks for keeping us company back home. He has been my guest, Job Mugira, an economist. Coming up next is why Mashariki, DJ Teska, and Ken Relbis will be here for you. I'll be seeing you again soon. Have yourself a very good night. My name is Dereva Hilewi. Goodbye.
Y254. Imagine.